Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out tonight for this special with Justin Brierley. We are so excited for all of you to be here. And Justin, thank you for being here, spending some extra time with us.
Oh, it's my absolute pleasure. And we've been introduced to all the delights of Dana Point. We were down on the beach this afternoon. We went over to San Clemente for a little bit of shopping. It's been great.
You got a little bit of a, I can't call it a tan, but you got something.
Yeah, something. My pasty white British skin is gradually getting on a slightly bronzer level, yeah.
So thank you to all of you that have submitted questions. We're going to try to get to as many as we can. So here's how it's going to go. I'm going to pray, and then Justin is going to address us for a few minutes. He's got a few things he's going to share, and then we'll get right into the questions for as long as we have. So to get us started, would you please pray with me? Dear good and gracious Father, Lord, we just thank you for the ability to think and to converse and to talk about the things of you. Lord, I thank you for this time with Justin and the wisdom that you have given him. Lord, as we just talk about the things of you and how we are to live following you in culture and in life and in your word, Lord, I just pray that your Holy Spirit will empower us to live more boldly for you in all the different spheres of our lives. And so, Lord, we just give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Great. Well, thank you again for coming out this evening. And it's been so lovely to spend some time with you and with your family, Micah, as well, in the last 24, 48 hours. And I hope we can return at some point as well to see you folk again. I just wanted to share really a little further on, I guess a lot of you were at yesterday morning services and perhaps heard what I had to say about some of the reasons we can give for the hope that we have. And I was sharing some of the aspects of the way the universe and our inner conscience and sense of purpose in the world point to God, make best sense by saying that there is a God behind all of this. And those have been helpful for me, especially in having those conversations with skeptics, agnostics, seekers. But I something that I didn't say, and I just felt it's important to make sure that you hear this, is that people aren't ultimately argued into the kingdom of God. People don't simply find arguments, you know, persuasive. Now, they may be important, actually. It may be that an intellectual route is important for people as they seek their way forward. But ultimately, the thing that really makes the difference in my experience is, you know, we talked about 1 Peter 3:15, always be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. It's those final words in that verse that, for me, make all the difference, because it's the way we have the conversation makes just as much difference as the things we say. You know, sadly, I've sometimes seen wonderful debaters, apologists, intellectual giants kind of really smash their opponent with the arguments, but in the process, they actually lose the person because they've made them feel little and made them feel like, you know, they were just there to be defeated. And what we really need to do, of course, is to encourage people with a relationship where we're open to them and we want to hear from them. They're not simply someone we're going to argue down and defeat in a battle of wits or intellect, but they're actually people to be loved, people to have a relationship with, people to treat as made in God's image and worthy of our respect and time. And for that reason, I would encourage you that one of the most important things you can show anyone apart from intellectual arguments is your life. It is your own story, and being able to just encourage someone in that way. I think of all of the atheists and skeptics who have engaged with me over the years on the show, and I've got to know a lot of them in person or simply over email, you know, regular people who email the show to say, well, I agreed with that or I disagreed with that. And what's interesting is what keeps a lot of the atheists and skeptics, even those, you know, who don't seem to have changed their mind over the years, but what keeps them engaged is actually the way the show runs. It's not particularly necessarily the figures who come on the arguments, but it's actually the fact that I'm there week in, week out, and they feel like they get to know me And they feel like, well, maybe I don't believe in this Christianity stuff, but I think Justin's an all right guy. So I think there's an amazing opportunity there to just develop those long-term relationships with people. I think it's so important to put that legwork in and to say, actually, this is not just about winning an argument. It's about actually showing someone what it looks like to be a Christian. You know, you may have the best arguments in the world, but if your life doesn't look attractive, people aren't going to be convinced because they're not going to want what's on offer at the other end. You know, people have to want. People have to not just be shown that Christianity is true through argument and evidence. They have to be shown why they want it to be true. And that's a different thing. It's, you know, there's that old saying, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. You have to make people thirsty for the gospel. You have to show them why it makes a difference, not just, you know, the reasons for why you believe it's true. And very often it's getting that thirst going in someone. And that's so often in those pastoral moments. That's so often in the way that your life makes them feel like, actually, maybe there's something missing in my life. It's that kind of thing that actually start people on that journey. And then, yeah, there may be an intellectual journey. That then it's a question of showing them the what and the how. But first of all, you need to show them that they want this to be true. And in my experience, as I say, you never know what's going on underneath with a lot of people. Many people who I never thought there was a chance that they would become a Christian surprised me. And something in their life clicked, some situation happened, and what do you know? Things turned around for them. So never give up on anyone, even that person you think would never, ever turn around and believe this stuff or come to Christ. It happens. It does happen. It's extraordinary what can happen, actually. And that's why I say it's not just about the argument. It's about the life we live. It's about praying. It's about bringing people before God. I just want to make sure that because a lot of yesterday was about those intellectual arguments, just to kind of make sure that we remember that it's only one side of a coin. In fact, the other side of the coin is kind of more important. It's our example, praying people. There's a spiritual battle going on just as much as there's an intellectual issue there. So thank you very much. And I hope that some of what I was able to share yesterday and hopefully this evening will be helpful as you go on and have those conversations. I met many of you yesterday who told me just a little bit about some of the folk that you're talking to and people that you have a real heart for, and I know that's not easy. I know what it's like. You know, we all know people we would love to see come through, and they haven't yet. Keep praying, keep loving on them. That's an American phrase that I've picked up. And just, you know, yeah. And God can do amazing things, so thank you. Yeah, I think we got some questions.
Yeah, I concur with everything you said, Justin. That was well said. All right, we're going to start with an easy one. This is probably our number one topic that we got asked about, and it's the topic of suffering.
Wow.
And in your book, you say this is the question for many skeptics. Mm. It is a rather sizable one. So how does a good God allow so much suffering in our world?
Yeah, well, start with the small one, for sure. Yeah, and a chapter really wasn't enough to do this justice. You know, a whole book really couldn't do this question justice, because the question of suffering, it goes back, I don't know, tens of thousands of years, doesn't it? I mean, the oldest book in the Bible, the book that was first written down, the book of Job, is all about suffering. It's the oldest question that there is, isn't it? And in a short answer, I'm not going to be able to in any way, and I should just say this as a caveat, everything I say this evening is me trying to do my best with where I'm at on these issues. You may not agree with the tack I take on every one of these issues, and I just ask you to accept that this is where I sit and my best kind of shot at some of these really tough questions. But on suffering, why does God allow so much suffering in the world? The first thing I'd want to say is that a lot of the suffering that exists in the world is not created by God. It's created by us, isn't it? And that's sort of the payoff of the fact that God has given us the freedom to love, but equally the freedom to not love, the freedom to serve, the freedom to be selfish. The thing is, if God did step in every moment and make sure we always did the right thing so that no one ever was selfish and no one ever was hateful, well, we wouldn't be us. We would be robots. We would be puppets. There would be no free will. And this is an important sort of philosophical issue, that the only way you can have free will, have the ability to love, to be truly human, God has to give us the option to either do what is right or actually to choose the other. And so much of the evil I see in the world, the suffering I see in the world, is sadly because humans have chosen not to do the right thing. So I think the problem I have sometimes with the question is people lay a lot of stuff at God's door, but actually we need to take responsibility for it. We're the ones who have actually messed up, who have created the kind of world in which suffering and evil can often flourish. Even sometimes, you know, there is this other question of, well, what about stuff that isn't down to us, you know, sometimes called natural evil, earthquakes, disease, those kinds of issues that we don't necessarily have control over in the same way. Now, that's a tough one. That is a tough one. Why do we live in that kind of a world? But even there, I want to just stop for a moment and say, even our freedom, the way we've chosen to use our resources in the world, have contributed to that. You look at somewhere where, you know, there is a high incidence of earthquakes, for instance, in the world. I think Los Angeles, you know, is essentially built on a fault line, isn't it? But earthquakes rarely cause major damage and disruption or death in that part of the world. Why? Because we have an infrastructure and we have, you know, the ability to mitigate for that and to make sure that our buildings are you know, earthquake-proof and everything else. Earthquakes of the same magnitude in another country like Haiti cause incredible damage and death and destruction. But what's the difference? Well, it's just that we live in a world where, sadly, we've created a world where there are vast differences in wealth, in equality. And so even in those situations, we need to ask ourselves, it's not just that, you know, we can't just blame everything on God. There's a fact is we've created a world in which those kinds of inequalities exist because we've been given the freedom and we don't always choose God's way, God's kingdom way. There's so much to say about this question, so forgive me for going a bit long on it. But ultimately, though, we live in a kind of a broken world. That's where I land. When you look at so much, whether it's human freedom that's causing the suffering, whether it seems to be disease or earthquakes or whatever going on in our world, it's kind of like, there, you know, in the story of Genesis, we have this picture of a world that has gone awry, where it's gone out of kilter. Sin has entered and somehow it's swept through the whole of creation and it's put the whole thing out of joint. And so for me, rather than blame God for suffering, I want to sort of flip it and say, actually, God knows all about the suffering, but God has brought a solution, and that is Jesus into the picture. And in him, in his death and in his resurrection, he started this new movement, this hope movement, where he's pushing forward to all of that being resolved. And in fact, all of that somehow counting towards our ultimate hope and our own resurrection. And we live in this kind of in-between time, the now and not yet of the kingdom of God, where we can see the brokenness and we can see the way that things aren't the way they ought to be, but we're being called by God to join him in this story of putting the world right. And it starts with Jesus Christ, and it's about all of us getting on board and being part of that putting right people of the kingdom of God. And that's about, absolutely, doing what we need to do in our local community to ensure that we live in a fairer world, in a better world. It's about making sure that we're heading towards a world where, you know, we don't see war and famine and those kinds of things. But there's also something about that eventual destination being a point at which God will put everything right himself as well. So that actually the ultimate destination is one where we don't live in a world where we're kind of fighting against the natural order, where death is part of the picture, where disease is part of the picture. We're promised a world in which all of that has been finally solved by God. All of that has been put right. But we are the people joining in God's putting right up to that moment when everything gets put right again. Why has God created it this way? Why did he do it this way? I think it's something to do with the fact that he wanted us to be part of this project, that he want that this is part of what it means to be human, to actually to experience suffering, to experience loss. It is part of the human condition. And somehow, in miraculous ways, God uses that to redeem and to make things new and better than they were before. You know, the whole point of the Christian story is that God came and experienced suffering himself and yet somehow redeemed it for the good of the whole of creation. And for me, that happened in Jesus and it happens in each of our individual lives. If we're willing to allow God to use us, he will use us and redeem the suffering and the brokenness around us. It's often a messy journey. You know, there are very rarely nice bow ties to put on these stories. But somehow, in the end, I believe that we live in a story that is hopeful, not a story that's a story of despair. It's a story, actually, that's got a happy ending because Jesus has shown us the way forward. It's a huge, huge area, and I've hardly done it justice with that. But those are just some initial thoughts to get us going.
No, that's great. But how would you help Christians talk to people who do not subscribe to the providence of God and his plan? Right? Because you're saying God is going to make all things new in the end.
Yeah.
Is that how you would talk to a non-believer about it?
It might not be the place I would begin. And I appreciate the question that came in on that, because there's the question that a Christian would ask, someone who believes in God, but says, but why would God allow this to happen? And then there's the question a skeptic would ask, which is, okay, you say there's a God, but look at the world around us, you know, how can you possibly believe that? The first thing I'd want to say to the skeptic is, okay, I get that, but let's just start with the terminology we're using in the first place. Are you telling me that you believe the world is, you know, that the world is not the way it should be if there's a God running it? Is that the point? And that's usually kind of what they're getting at. The world is, it's not a fair place, it's not a just place. If there's a God in charge of this thing, then they're not doing their job properly, basically. And my first point would be, if there is no God, if actually we're just living in a universe that is running according to the laws of nature, matter in motion, this kind of idea of naturalism I talked about yesterday, then it doesn't even make sense to talk about right and wrong, justice or fairness. Those concepts don't actually exist in such a universe. To even get to the point of talking about why would God allow this, how is this just, why does evil exist, you can't have a concept of evil without a God who invests that kind of meaning in the universe. There simply are no right and wrongs, no evils, no justice. There just is the universe and the way it functions if you are an atheist. And so if you want to talk about justice, if you want to talk about right and wrong, you kind of have to start with God in the first place. You can't sort of say, you know, it's not fair, God, you know, the world's unfair, therefore God doesn't exist. You can't talk about fairness without a concept of God. This was actually the thing that drew C.S. Lewis, who was an atheist to begin with, to theism, to belief in God. He has this very famous passage in his book, Mere Christianity, where he talks about his conversion, and he says, the problem I had as an atheist with the world was that, you know, it was so unfair. But where had I got this concept of fairness from? He said, a man cannot call a crooked line straight unless he has some idea of what a straight line is. And the point he was making is that there, you can only have that concept if there's a God who makes sense of that in the first place. So that's kind of where I'd want to start with my atheist friend, is to say, you talk about justice, you talk about fairness, where does that even come from if there's no God in the universe? But once we've established that, I'd want to say to them, look, it's a mystery. I accept that. I'm not going to stand here and claim that I can answer all your questions about why a good God would allow suffering in the world. But I do believe that I'd rather live with the mystery of that than with the meaninglessness of the atheist answer. Because suffering still exists if you're an atheist, okay? It's just, there is no rhyme or reason to it. It just is a brute fact of nature. It's just, you know, you just have to lump it. I would rather live in a world in which I accept there's a mystery to life and a mystery to how God is going to redeem and put this all together again, than to live in a world where it really is meaninglessness. And if you get dealt the short straw in life, that's just the way it goes. I believe that everything will be made right in the end. And for me, that is a story of hope to live into. And it's ultimately a story that I think a lot of people, even skeptics, find attractive. Because ultimately, living in a kind of meaningless, nihilistic kind of view of reality, it's hard to live that way because we're not built to do that internally. I think that we have a real sense, actually, that there is more to life, as I was talking about yesterday. Absolutely, if you're going to say there's a God, you're going to have to come to terms with how do I reconcile that. For me, the ultimate way in which I do that, you know, if there's anything in just a short moment I would point people to who are asking these questions, it would be Jesus. I would say Christianity is the story of a God who didn't stand far off in suffering, you know, to watch the world go to rack and ruin. He came in and he became part of the solution to sin and evil and suffering. We have a God who knows what it is like to suffer. Okay, that can make all the difference to a parent who's lost a child or someone who's going through terrible suffering. You know, my intellectual arguments may not make it much difference for someone who's going through grief and torment, but knowing that God has experienced that may make the difference, may make them able to stand and be able to just hang on, because that's ultimately where the real heart of this question is. It's rarely just an intellectual issue for people. It's about the fact people have been through suffering and are going through suffering, and the fact that we have a God who knows and has experienced suffering himself, I think is a huge thing.
Yeah, I think even to add what you're saying, and to equip ourselves how to have these conversations, not just to be the people that have all the answers, even asking the question to the skeptic of, well, how do you answer suffering? Yeah. Since they all have to have an answer to that question.
Yeah, and if profitable. The answer is, you just got to suck it up, well, okay, that's an answer, but it's not an answer that's actually necessarily going to get people through life, you know.
We are going to move to the Bible. And so one of the questions we received is, do you have to believe every word in the Bible to be Christian? Some of the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, seems to be written to justify why one group of people, the Israelites, can kill and plunder the other groups of people.
Wow. You saved the hard
softballs
ones for the
here,
beginning.
Justin,
yeah,
softballs.
Absolutely.
We're going softballs.
You know, so many of these questions are questions that I am still working out. And I'm just going to be honest with that. You know, I'm not saying that I have the answer to all these questions. So there are lots of things that are still filed under I don't know, or this is still a bit of a mystery to me. I've got some thoughts on this, but I'm not saying this is the definitive answer. In fact, I think what I'll do is I'll sketch out a few different possibilities. Okay. I mean, the general question, which is, do you have to believe every word in the Bible to be a Christian? The thing is with the Bible is, as I'm sure you're all aware, it's a library of books, yeah? It's 66 books, actually. And like any library, if you walked into a library, you wouldn't go to the math section and expect to find out how to cook a dish. You wouldn't go to the poetry section and expect to read a history of, you know, the United States. There's a point. Different types of genre of literature all have different ways in which they need to be read and understood in order to appreciate the truth that they bring us. And it's the same with the Bible. You've got lots of different types of literature in the Bible. And so to say, do you have to believe every word in the Bible to be a Christian? Well, I believe every word in the Bible is inspired by God. But every word in the Bible needs to be read intelligently, needs to be understood in its context and what the author is trying to say and what genre is being spoken to. So you're not going to read the book of Proverbs in the same way that you read the Gospel of Luke. You're not necessarily going to read the first few chapters of Genesis in exactly the same way as you read the book of Acts. There's going to be ways in which we have to understand the context that these books were being written into and the way that we intelligently are supposed to understand and read them. So in that sense, yes, I believe every word in the Bible is true, it's inspired, but we need to be careful readers of Scripture and make sure that we understand how to read and interpret those words. And that's the work of a lifetime as we get to grips with Scripture and we, you know, have good teaching and we kind of get to grips with that. The specific question about the Old Testament and especially some of the warfare and violence we find in some of those Old Testament books, this is a tough one. There's no doubt about that. And there are a few different ways I might give you as suggestions for approaching this. The first one is, we are a long way removed from the people and the times and places of the Old Testament. And it's very difficult, I think, for us in our culture to understand what it involved to just be a people called out by God, but basically constantly in danger of being wiped out. That is what the Israelite people were. And what may look to us like kind of quite extreme acts on the part of the Israelite army and so on, may just be the way you had to act in that culture in order to survive. They didn't have, you know, they didn't have a prison system in those days. They didn't have a way of keeping people penned in. There are lots of reasons why what looks to us like really, you know, full-on, quite harsh commands might have made more sense in their time and place. So there's one way of looking at it like that. You have to look at things in their historical context and understand that in a very different time, in a very different place, and for a very particular purpose, there may have been arguably a reason why God might have issued commands that involved the destruction of people or the destruction and so on. Now, having said that, there's also, again, it's helpful, there's a few books I could recommend on this front to understand, again, some of the context of the commands themselves. So, for instance, there's a book called Is God a Moral Monster by Paul Copan. And he and others have pointed out that when we actually get into the specifics of the text, which people often object to, where God seems to issue commands to go and wipe out the Canaanites or the Amorites and so on, what's actually happening in those contexts is actually a kind of warfare that was understood to be between armies. And so even if it says, you know, wipe everyone out, don't leave anything living, men, women, children, animals, it's understood that actually what was being attacked is a sort of a fortress, essentially, and that the language being used is a kind of hyperbolic language, the way that we might say, you know, the Raiders wiped out the Dodgers, or I don't know what these teams are. But, you know, it's kind of hyperbole. and the point is... Did I get my sports?
That was football and baseball in one metaphor.
But my point is that we use hyperbole all the time, and the writers of Scripture kind of it's there in Scripture that there's a kind of some hyperbolic use of language to say, you know, wipe it out. But actually, what's realistically would have been happening is, you know, attacks on specific fortresses with soldiers in, not with women, not with children in, and so on. Now, there's a lot of arguments there. So there's a lot different ways of looking at it, and you know, arguably you could say, well, that seems to tone it down. That means, you know, it's not as bad as maybe it looks at first glance. Personally, I say some of that stuff is helpful, but where I tend to go with this stuff is not to try and too much kind of say, look, maybe it was different in that time of culture, maybe, you know, there are different ways of understanding it. I always want to go back to Jesus, and I want to say, okay, I don't really understand the Old Testament. There's a lot of stuff in there that is very different culturally, different time and place, the Israelite people. But what I do understand is Jesus Christ. And in the book of Hebrews, it says, God spoke to us in many ways in times and places through the prophets and through the story of Israel. But in this time and place, he has revealed himself to us in Jesus Christ, and he's given us this perfect likeness of God. And what that tells me is that we get pictures of God throughout the whole of Scripture, but we get a unique, perfect revelation of God in Jesus Christ. And I have to interpret all those other pictures where you get little bits and pieces and parts of the puzzle in the Old Testament through the lens of Jesus Christ, who is the perfect representation of God. And I have to say, well, look, I don't really understand exactly what was going on in those situations, but I do know that Jesus calls me to love my enemy, to bless those who persecute me, and to win this world through love and not through violence. Now, that has to be my filter through which I then look at the Old Testament and say, I don't know exactly why or what God's purposes were, but I do know that somehow Jesus Christ has changed the game. There's been a game change here whereby now judgment isn't visited through war, through destruction. Jesus bore the judgment. Jesus has suffered violence himself so that we can be a people who actually go out and our weapons are prayer and weapons of love and so on. And somehow we have to have that picture of Jesus as a kind of filter to say, whatever that stuff in the Old Testament is, we're looking at it now through the paradigm of Christianity, of Jesus Christ. And that means that I can be, the one thing I can be sure about is that God deals in love and mercy and justice. And I believe in a God who was loving and just and merciful across the whole of the Old Testament. But I'm going to have to say it's Jesus through whom I'm going to understand that God primarily, because I'm not wise enough to know everything about the Old Testament and the circumstances and the issues and the way God had to work in different times and places. But I do know that he's given us Jesus to show us exactly what he looks like. And that is the picture of God that I'm going to turn to in the end.
I love that. That's even here at South Shores, we call it Christ-centered preaching. So we believe that every book of the Bible that we preach through is pointing to Jesus in some way, shape, or form. So right now we're going through the minor prophets. In some way that is, you know, God's plan, his story is pointing forward towards Christ. But I can see on your show, on Unbelievable, if with that response, the atheist would probably could come back and say, well, does that mean, how do you reconcile the God of the New Testament and the God of the Old Testament? Are they the same God?
So yeah.
What would you say?
Yeah, and this is a great question that came in. And I would say you've got the same God throughout the whole Bible, okay? Let's be very clear about that. You know, there have been attempts in the past. There was a famous heretic called Marcion who tried to basically do away with the Old Testament and say, no, it was a different God, you know. No, the Old Testament is essential. The Old Testament is the, you know, Jesus is the culmination of the Old Testament. You can't have Christianity without that whole story of the Israelite people and God who was with them then and the God who makes himself known in Jesus Christ. The difference is that we have been brought into a living relationship with God. The fact is that God dealt in a different way with people in the past because there was a different kind of way in which God was trying to bring them into a new realization of who he was. So, yeah, the story of the people of Israel is a story of God essentially taking a small group and saying, I am going to show you who I am. And I'm going to do it through this whole series of, you know, events and tests and challenges. And there's going to be these very important laws that you need to keep. And it's all about showing in the midst of a very pagan culture where essentially gods are there to be appeased and, you know, and have to essentially, the cults are basically there to kind of try to make sure that you don't get struck off by God. God comes and does something very different and says, I'm going to make a covenant with you. If you're faithful to me, I will be faithful to you. In fact, and even when they're not faithful to him, I'm going to be faithful to you. And I'm going to show you who I am over and against all of these other religions around you. And that means you're going to have to be a special people. You're going to have to do special things that show in all kinds of ways the way that I am with you through this. And of course, ultimately, that whole story finds its ultimate purpose in Jesus Christ, its ultimate significance and culmination. And it's at that point that we see, as I said, the same God coming to that final point in Jesus Christ and saying, this was what it was all leading up to. And now, the story that I've been telling through the people of Israel can now be told in the big way to the whole of the world. And for me, there's no need to see those as two different gods. It's the same God. It's just the God we relate to that God in a whole new way through Jesus Christ. You know, we don't have to go through the sacrifices. We don't have to go through the ritual. We have a God who comes close, you know, by his Spirit in Jesus Christ. And yeah, that, you know, it's so helpful, I think, to sometimes do those deep dives. Sometimes you can just open up a book of the Old Testament and you think, my goodness, what are all these laws for? Why does God seem to act in this way or that way? Doing a bit of deeper research, a bit of theological study, really helps, I think, to show the way in which all of it, as you said, Micah, is pointing forward to Jesus Christ and finds its ultimate fulfillment in him. So, yeah, I think, you know, it's a journey to go on, but it's worth doing.
Good. The next question we got was, what do you say to the non-believer that asks, what makes Christianity the right path and Jesus the one true God? What about other religions?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think we're really blessed in Christianity because Christianity is almost uniquely among all of the world religions, a religion that is based on historical facts. Facts that are accessible to everyone. It's interesting, if you go and look at a lot of the other religions that tend to dominate the world, you will find that they have their beliefs, but their beliefs essentially are derived from ancient sort of stories that don't have any particular historical basis, or they derive from particular personal dreams or visions. If you go to Islam, you know, it's about a personal vision that Muhammad claimed to have had, you know, in which he was delivered the Quran and so on. Likewise, Mormonism, you know, it's about this personal set of, visions and claims, you know, that Joseph Smith had. The problem with those religions is none of them are kind of publicly verifiable. You know, it's just one person claiming to have had one particular experience. That's not the case with Christianity. Christianity is rather unique as a religion because the events that it claims took place at a certain time and place in world history when there were lots of people around who could verify or deny whether these things happened. A whole group of people at one point started claiming that a man called Jesus had claimed to be the Messiah of Israel and that he'd been put to death and that he'd risen again. Now, the facts around his claims and his death were public knowledge. You know, it was very well attested. Even today, 2,000 years removed from that, the crucifixion of Jesus is one of the best attested facts of history, bar none. I mean, it is extraordinary how good the evidence is for the life and death of Jesus Christ. The claim of the resurrection is really interesting because that, of course, is the central claim of the whole Christian faith. And again, it's interesting that it's not just some private visitation, some personal dream that someone claimed, oh, yeah. It was a whole group of people who claimed to have seen Jesus Christ alive again. And there's a whole bunch of reasons why that testimony seems to make an awful lot of historical sense. There's a lot of things I could list off, but the fact that the first people who claimed to have seen the tomb empty were women. You don't go around making that kind of stuff up in first century Israel because the testimony of a woman was worth far less than that of a man. But interestingly, in a kind of reverse way, 2,000 years later, by a certain sort of historical method called the criterion of embarrassment, historians see that that actually counts very strongly for the fact that the Christians talking about this story weren't making it up. You wouldn't invent women as the first discoverers of the empty tomb in that time and place. It wouldn't have made sense if you were trying to pull the wool over the eyes of people. And yet that's the story they presented. So it has the ring of truth to it. Okay, something weird happened. And again, you have these, what even skeptical historians will admit, which is that people claim to have seen the risen Jesus. People, you know, who were formerly enemies of the Christian movement converted because they claimed to have seen the risen Jesus. Something historical happened. These are things that were attested to. You know, one of the, I mean, absolute gold in the New Testament from a historical point of view are the letters of Paul, especially things like 1 Corinthians 15, where he talks about, the sort of what got handed to him as this kind of testimony of Jesus's life and death and resurrection. And that letter was written probably in the sort of 50s AD, so just 20 or so years after, you know, the claimed events of Jesus's death and resurrection. But he's quoting from a kind of creed that had already been established in the Christian church, which scholars say probably goes back to within just a couple of years of the events themselves. You never get that close to events in ancient history in any other field. The New Testament is incredible at how early it shows us that these Christians were claiming that something amazing had happened. All of this is just to say, Christianity isn't just something someone dreamed up. It's something that has an incredibly strong historical basis. So when the person asks, what makes Christianity the right path and Jesus the one true God? The reason we can be confident of the claims of Christianity is because it actually has a really strong historical basis. And so I've got good reason to believe that if Jesus was who he said he was, if he did die, and if he did rise again, then that's a game changer. You know, one analogy I've used for this is, you know, when people ask, well, how do you know Christianity is true out of all the religions that exist in the world? I've said, you know, so my wife's a pastor, and when we go to our church, I've got a bunch of keys to open up the door, and they all look kind of the same. So I might try one in the lock. No, it's not that one. I try the next one. No. Try the next. Oh, the third one works. Open the door. What I don't then do is try every other key in the lock to see if it'll open the door. I found the one key that opens the door. I don't need to search through all the rest. I think it's the same with religion. If you found the one key that opens the door, if it's true that Jesus Christ is who he said he was, that he died and he rose again, then you don't need to go and look through every other religion to find out if it's true. You know you found the one that is the true one. It's not like you have to search exhaustively. And for me, that's really important. The life, death, and resurrection of Jesus is the central thing which tells us that actually, yes, this is the true, this is the way that God has spoken to us definitively through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And it's not like it's just a kind of roulette as to which one of these religions might be true or not. There's a really good historical reason to believe that Christianity is the truth. Does that answer the question? I mean, what about other religions? I guess that's a whole other kind of question. Well, we're kind of going to cover that a little bit later on, aren't we? With those, there's a question about what about people who've never heard the gospel. Maybe
why don't we go to that one? So
wrap it into that.
I mean, certainly, to your point, as Christians, we have an abundance of riches of evidence and historical record. But what about the people that have never heard of Jesus? Maybe they live, in a place that was, the unreached.
Yeah.
And they live their life and past, and they had never heard the name. Yeah. So what about those type of people?
Again, this is one where I'm going to say, this is my perspective on this, and you're welcome to disagree with it. But for me, I don't think we're called to necessarily know or judge what God does with people who just don't have access to the name of Jesus. I am very, very happy to leave that to God. God is a far better judge of that than I could possibly be. All I know is that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that everyone who comes to God comes through him. Now, what that means for people who have never had the opportunity, I do not know. But what I do believe in is a God who is perfectly just, far more just than I ever could be, and he will do right by people. Now, whether that means that there's some kind of opportunity where maybe God can judge the heart of every person who hasn't had the opportunity to respond to him, maybe it's something like that. But I don't know. I don't know. All I know is I believe in a God who is perfectly loving, perfectly just, and no one on the final day of judgment will be able to say, I wasn't treated fairly. So for me, that's where the buck stops, really, that I believe God will do right by every person. The question of other religions is a slightly different question, because there's that question of, well, why are there all these other religions in the world, and what about them, you know? And for me, again, it's about actually saying, you know, you go back to the book of Acts, there were lots of other religions around. You know, this is not a new question. There were lots of other pagan beliefs and gods and, you know, people asking, you know, people following different ways. And it's interesting when you see what Paul does when he's in that situation. You know, he goes to Athens in Acts 17 and he talks to the philosophers and the people, you know, and the pagans. And he says, I see, you know, you've got all of these statues to all of these gods. And he says, I want to proclaim to you the true God, he uses the example of a plinth he saw to an unknown God, just in case there was one God they'd missed off. And he says, I want to proclaim to you that God has made himself known. The unknown God has now been made known through Jesus Christ. And interestingly, when he does that, he doesn't condemn their search through their other gods necessarily. In fact, he quotes their own playwrights and poets back to them. He says, for in him we move and live and have our very being. He's quoting the pagan philosophers to them, but he's kind of turning it on its head and saying, you know what, guys? You've been looking around. You've been fumbling in the dark. You've been looking for God. I can see that you're searching for God all around here. Guess what? God's now come in person. God's been revealed. He doesn't say, how stupid of you all to have believed in these other gods. What he says is, I know you've been searching, but guess what? Now your search has been fulfilled. And I feel like it's like that with every religion in the world. I don't go to someone who is a Buddhist or a Muslim or another faith and say, you crazy evil person for believing that thing. I understand that every person is looking for God. Every person is on a quest searching for God. What we can hold out to someone is to say, your search has been fulfilled. Jesus fulfills all of those longings and deep desires that you have. And actually, he's all offering this to you now. Now, again, I'm not going to judge what God does with every single person of a different faith and a different religion. But all I know is that Jesus is the ultimate thing that they were always looking for. And in the end, I believe God will do just, you know, that God will see to it that everyone who was looking for him, seeking him, knocking on the door, they'll find him.
Okay. Why don't we move to creation? A question came in. Do you see the earth as young, about 6,000 years old, or ancient, about 14 billion years old?
I'm going to be straight with you on this one. I do believe in an ancient earth, in an old universe. So I do believe what the science tells us, that this is that we live in a universe that came into existence by our best reckoning about 14 billion years ago. I have a tremendous amount of respect for a lot of my friends who take a different view on that, who take what's often called a young earth creation view, that actually that it's only a sort of about 6,000 years old, the earth, and they have their reasons for believing that, and I respect people who take that perspective, and we've done lots of discussions and debates on the show between those different perspectives. This for me is not an issue that we should fall out over, ideally. We do fall out over it, unfortunately. But for me, I think it's important to recognize that people in good standing with, you know, a genuine faith and absolutely orthodox convictions when it comes to Christianity can agree to disagree on this issue. And it shouldn't be something where we kind of disfellowship people or make it an issue that says, quote-unquote, salvation issue. The fact is, I believe that there's actually good reason to believe that we're living in an old universe and that Genesis doesn't have to be read in a way in which we can simply count back the years to sort of 6,000 years and believe that was when everything started. I think I would go with a different way of understanding, especially those very early chapters of Genesis, about what's going on there. I don't think we're meant to read it as a scientific textbook, in a sense. It's more about the principles, about the way God creates, why he creates, the fact that we're made in his image. It's not necessarily meant to be read as a sort of chronology in terms of years of how long it was from then until now. And for me, I think there's actually a really fruitful, there's a lot actually that I think is very interesting. I mean, and I referred to it yesterday in my talk, the fact that our best science is actually pointing towards the idea of a beginning of the universe 14 billion years ago. The fact that actually there's a lot around us that makes that points to God if we do actually look at the scientific record and, you know, and take it seriously in that way. And for me, that doesn't have to at all be in conflict with the Bible. In fact, I think people often say, you know, God gave us the book of Revelation in the Bible, and he gave us the book of nature as well. And these are two amazing books that God has given us, and they don't need to conflict. In fact, they're both talking about his glory revealed in the universe and his glory obviously revealed in Jesus in Scripture. So for me, I go for an old earth and an old universe, and I think that that just goes to show God's majesty even more.
And it does seem culturally we have pitted faith and science against each other. And I love what you're saying. How do we get them going together? Would you have more to say on how do we as Christians, when we're talking to someone and they say, well, that's just faith, that's not science. Yeah. How do we continue in that conversation and show that they're aligned and not against each other?
Yeah, I mean, I'd want to know exactly why that person thinks that there's a conflict there, who they've been reading, what arguments they've been seeing. But as I said yesterday in what I shared from the stage, I want to show that person that our best science does in no way mitigates against Christianity, doesn't point against the truth of God. It actually is pointing towards there being a real design behind the universe that you know, so many physicists I meet who, you know, are not religious people, but they often use very religious language when they're talking about the universe. They talk about the beauty, the grandeur. They talk about this incredible mystery behind the universe, that there just seems to be this synchronicity that allows for us to be here and for us to understand the universe itself. I mean, that is as one Nobel Prize winning physicist, Eugene Wigner, put it, he said, there is basically a miracle at the center of physics, which is the fact that we can understand physics. He says, there's no reason why the universe should be written in the laws of mathematics. He says, either it's an extraordinary fluke or there's something really weird going on in the universe. And I think there is something really weird going on in the universe. I think there's a God behind it. And actually, for me, you know, the more I look at the science, the more I see actually there's this extraordinary convergence between God and science. So, you know, the atheists who kind of say, you know, science and faith are at odds with each other, I get why they say that. But generally, it's just all that argument is depending on is a very wooden, literalistic understanding of a few chapters of Scripture. And once you kind of simply, I think, are willing to just see things in a slightly different way, those problems kind of evaporate. And actually, there's, you know, the fact is, Christianity birthed modern science. I mean, a lot of people forget this. You know, they think that somehow, you know, science is some kind of atheistic enterprise. It hasn't been, and it still isn't. The greatest pioneers of the scientific revolution were all Christians. They were all believers. And the reason they did their science was because they believed in an orderly universe that was out there to be discovered, because they believed there was a God who'd put it in place. So it is a complete myth, the science-faith conflict. It was cooked up about 150 years ago. And if you actually go and look at it, it's just not the case. Christians have been at the forefront, historically, of scientific progress.
So just to push back a little bit, what would you say to the Christian who says, well, if you can change how you read those first few chapters in Genesis, what stops you from reading maybe the Gospels or other parts of Scripture in a different way?
That's an absolutely fair thing. And I'd go back to the point I made at the beginning about the fact that we're dealing with a book full of different genres. And there are some parts of Scripture which are clearly meant to be read as historical parts, you know, as historical accounts of what happened. The Gospels are a good example. They fit into a very clear genre of ancient literature called historical biography. We have other similar examples of other famous figures of the past. And Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, did I get that right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I sometimes insert Ringo as well. But the point is that they're clearly meant to be read as telling us about real events, real times, real places. You know, these are not mythical accounts. Likewise, many of the annals of the Old Testament and so on, they're meant to be understood as historical accounts. I think there is a genuine debate about when you get to those very early chapters about how exactly they're supposed to be read. And my best understanding is that they're not necessarily meant to be read in the same way that those historical accounts are. There's something different going on there. They're written in a very different kind of way. And I don't think they in any way deliver us any less truth in the fact that they're written to be understood in a different way by the reader.
Why don't we switch over to evangelism? Coming from the UK, you're probably, in terms of a post-Christian culture, a little further along from us. So even when we were talking last night, you come from the future, I think is what I said. So the question is, more people today seem to view religion and church as strange and even an agent of injustice. What do you see as a path forward to evangelize a people who are hostile to religion and Christianity in particular?
Yeah, wow, that's a great question. I've had so many conversations in recent years about the fact that we're living in a culture where increasingly a lot of people do see the church in very negative terms. And it's a huge shame, because actually what I tend to find is that when you actually go to a church and you meet the people in the pews, it's a very different story to kind of what often is kind of represented in the media and in the popular culture. You know, I meet a lot of people who say, I think the church is a terrible thing, you know, Christianity is terrible. And when you ask them, well, which Christians are you thinking of? Which churches are you thinking of? Well, oh no, all the Christians I know are fine. They're good. But no, generally. And the fact is, I think there's a kind of, the problem is that a picture has been painted in secular culture that the church is this way or that way. And what Christians need to do, I think, to counter that is just to show in person that people have got the wrong impression. Now, I'm sure there are many churches where things have gone wrong, where there have been, you know, toxic situations. I think there are parts of the wider church culture where we do need to look at ourselves and ask, well, what have we done potentially to make people think that we're, you know, intolerant and hateful or whatever it might be, okay? And we need to make sure that we're actually, you know, we want to stand firm on the principles we hold, but we also want to extend as much grace and love to people as we possibly can. And if we're not doing that, then we need to take a firm look at ourselves and ask why. Ultimately, the question is, you know, I do wonder, I suppose, whether the pendulum will swing back eventually. Because I look at the culture we're in right now, and people may think, oh, the church isn't a place where I'll find love or acceptance or anything like that. But I don't see an awful lot of love and acceptance in the general culture either, okay? We're living through this increasing amount of polarization, culture wars, even atheism, you know, as a movement. The new atheism, when it sprung up, you know, it was all about religion is terrible, you know, we need to fight against this cancer. But the new atheism itself kind of imploded, because once all these, you know, atheist thinkers had agreed that God didn't exist, they then couldn't agree on anything else. They couldn't agree on how life should be lived. And there were all kinds of dramas and controversies as people fell out with each other, conferences got cancelled because, you know, this person is no... You know, Richard Dawkins, he was given a Humanist of the Year award back in the 1990s. Last year, he got stripped of it by the American Humanist Association because they didn't like what he was saying about transgender anymore. You know, there's all these sorts of issues that are bubbling up in the culture. And all it goes to show is that people make a mess of things, you know, whoever they are. That's the human nature, okay? And right now, if people feel like, you know, well, you know, I don't want to go to church because I don't think the people will be very nice there, I think you only have to give it some time and people realize, you know, everyone is human, people in the church as well, that actually part of what the church is about is actually learning to be a community who love each other despite our differences and our failures. And I think what we need to start doing is model to a culture that is kind of falling apart and disagreeing with each other what it could look like if you took a whole bunch of people who are all very different to each other and you got together and you lived the kind of community life where you can actually see the love of Jesus, the person of Jesus, flowing out from that. And if we haven't done a good job of that, now is the time to start doing a good job of that, because actually I think people are still searching for that kind of purpose, that kind of meaning, that kind of community. And the way I would put it is that, you know, you have this image of tides coming in and out, you know, here down on the beach, I'm sure you have high tide and low tide. I feel that we're at a really low tide right now. The tide of Christianity in the West has kind of gone really far out, and it's been replaced by all kinds of other stories about reality. But I think it's reaching its limit. I think people are realizing that materialism, atheism, scientism, secularism, it doesn't fulfill. It doesn't answer their questions. And I think that tide is, at some point, is going to come back in. And Christians need to be ready to be people of love, people of community, who are ready to welcome people who are basically going through a meaning crisis, an identity crisis in our culture, and ready to welcome them back in. I don't know if that answers the question, but I guess all I would say is ultimately, we're asked to do what we've always been asked to do, which is to be Jesus Christ to the people around us. It may feel like right now we're in this kind of time when nobody wants to hear our message. People are, you know, against us. People don't, you know, the culture seems to be against the church or whatever. Tides come back in. Things change. You may just find that we happen to be living through that time now, but there's going to be a time when people need to hear this message again and want to hear this message again because they're being fed such a thin diet in the culture that we have. People are eventually going to get sick of it. And we just need to be the Church of Jesus Christ, faithful as we can be, doing what we need to do in our own lives, in the lives of our communities, holding out the hope of Jesus Christ, and praying faithfully. And I believe God's going to do the rest. We may not see it immediately. We might not even see it in our lifetime. But I believe what Jesus said, that the gates of hell will not prevail, that actually the church is the hope of the world. And we just need to pray, get on our knees, and ask God to continue.
Amen. Almost feel we should just end on that, but we've got a few more. Yesterday, in your sermon, you discussing Roe v. Wade and the overturning of that. Wow. How have you found discussing the topic of abortion helpful, or what ways have you found to be helpful?
Well, the first thing I would say is there are obviously big differences between the UK and the US situation. There's just a very different history on this issue, and to that extent, I don't claim to be an expert on the way that the issues play out here. What I would say is that in my experience, it's, as I said yesterday, really, in regards to the Christian atheist thing, it's so important to listen to both sides. Even if we have a strongly held conviction on one side, it's important to hear and to listen to both sides. Because these are obviously deeply held issues. Mm-hmm. And even if we do come, obviously, you know, and I'm sure many of the folk here, you know, take a staunchly pro-life position, and I believe in the life of a baby, you know, in the womb, I still want to understand the circumstances that would drive someone to potentially go that route of terminating a pregnancy. I think what we all understand and we should take for granted is that abortion is always a tragedy. It's no one, I don't think any woman goes into, you know, that any woman wants that to be the outcome of their life, okay? And to that extent, we need to just understand that and sympathize and try to empathize with the fact that this is never, you know, this is not about people kind of necessarily trying to do something evil. It's about people who are in tragic situations, who are in situations that are incredibly sad. And in the light of that, I think it's about actually finding ways to get to the point where tragedies don't happen, you know. Now, that may be a legal route. And, you know, I can understand why in the US that has been such a significant thing to see Roe versus Wade overturned. And from what I've spoken about to people who know about it, there are all kinds of reasons why, you know, it makes sense for that ruling to be overturned and for the power to return to local states and so on that front. But in the bigger picture, I think another thing that I've heard and that I think has struck me quite deeply is if we're going to celebrate that, let's also make sure that we are pro-life across the board. You know, let's make sure that women aren't, you know, ideally aren't getting to a situation where they would have to take that, where they would want to consider that option. And for us, that's about, as Christians, are we doing the kind of work and creating the kind of community where actually people can be supported and don't have to, you know, consider that kind of a route. And that's a much bigger, harder thing in many ways to go for. Because it's one thing to change a law, it's another thing to change our culture, into a life-giving, life-affirming culture rather than a life, you know, a culture of death. And for me, that's the much bigger battle in a way than just a legal ruling. I think it's about actually changing the culture so that every woman, family and child has the maximum opportunity they can have to flourish and to be brought into this world, you know.
That's why as Christians, especially here in the States, our work has just begun. It hasn't just ended.
Exactly, yeah. And I think that's a really good way to see it, you know. And as I say, I do not claim to be in any way, you know, an expert on these matters. But I am glad to see so many people who are working hard to really see women helped across the board rather than just in one particular way.
So if there was one final word you would give to the American church, from your 15 years of debates and conversations, you could just lob a grenade and then go back across the pond, what would it be?
I would say, remember that Jesus loves the church. And we often fail to look like Jesus. We often fail to represent Jesus to the world around us. But Jesus is still here. Jesus is still moving. Jesus is not finished with the church. But I would want to encourage you to not just, maybe to just take a step back and realize you have an amazing church here, an amazing facility. And I love visiting other churches in the States and seeing the amazing work that goes on. There's so many positives. But sometimes I think we also need to kind of see ourselves as just one small part of a much bigger picture. A lot of the people I've met, there's a kind of buzzword at the moment in my world, and it's called deconstruction. People who have questioning faith, who have maybe been raised in the evangelical church in the States, but have now left the faith or have, you know, started to kind of really question Christian orthodoxy and so on. Very often what I find they're questioning is not so much intellectual objections. It's a certain church culture maybe that they were raised in, a certain what they feel was like a negative or somehow toxic atmosphere. And every story is different, and you don't know, you know, what's happened in many people's story. But I often feel like what would have helped a lot of those people, rather than sort of just abandoning Christianity, would have just been to help them see that their particular church culture that they grew up in, their particular instantiation of Christianity, wasn't the whole picture. That there's a much bigger thing that God is doing, yes, here in the US, but across the whole world. That God's church goes back 2,000 years, and it will be here in the future. And that there's a much bigger picture out there. You know, I wish people could go and visit the church in Nigeria. I wish people could go and visit the church in Namibia, where Lucy and I worshiped for 8 months. I wish people could see the extraordinary things that God has done in other times and places and cultures and churches, and realize that this is much bigger than just my particular, you know, what happened to me in my particular church, and that God is in the business of creating something much bigger than any single one of us or our church network or our, you know, our individual churches. And just to pray that God will use us as God wants to in our particular time and place. You know, maybe we're not due to go back to some glory days, you know, that once existed in the 1950s or whatever, where, you know, we had this perfect Christian America, supposedly. But actually, God's always moving forward. Don't get disheartened or desolate or sort of say, oh no, it's all going to hell in a handbasket, you know. Actually, I'm an optimist. I believe the best is yet to come, that actually God is always on the move. God is always doing something. The tide will come in again, and God wants us to be ready, faithfully praying, loving, serving, and ready when the time comes to be people who represent him to the world, as we should be doing every day. Just keep doing it faithfully. Just keep praying. Just keep talking. Keep having the conversations, and you know, let God do the rest.
Justin Brierley, thank you for your time. Thank you for being here the last 2 days.
Thank you.
He'll stick around a little bit. Maybe you can catch his ear and talk to him. All of you people bought all the books that we had. We thought we'd overbought for all of you, but you can put your name on a list if you pay tonight. We will order it and get it back to you in the next week or so and get that discount under Amazon. So anyway, thank you for coming out tonight and go in his grace.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.